The part of God's word that we will consider together this morning is our gospel lesson for today. It's taken from the gospel according to St. Matthew, the 4th chapter, beginning with verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread." But Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God." Then the devil took him into the holy city. He placed him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, so that they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, you shall not test the Lord your God." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. He said to him, "I will give you all these things if you will bow down and worship me." And then Jesus said to him, "Go away, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him. And the angels came and served him. This is the word of our Lord. Dear Christian friends, when we consider the sacrifice of our Savior, when we consider the grace of our God, how far does that reach? How important is that? Well, I want you to think about, well, just this morning. Was there a battle in your heart this morning? Were there hard decisions that you had to make? Maybe the decision was, do I really want to get out of bed? Do I really want to go through the effort of getting ready to go to church again? Do I really want to wrestle with my kids and get them to go to church again? Maybe the battles are a little grimmer. Maybe it's a battle with an addiction or depression or pornography or greed or pride. What's your record, wins versus losses, against those temptations? I think one of the things we recognize, it's not good. We're very familiar, far too familiar, what it feels like to fall into sin, to fail the test, not to be what God wants us to be. So Jesus came. During Lent, we remember that Jesus came in our place because we don't live up to his standards. We needed someone who would. And we have someone who did. And now that we live in forgiveness, we recognize that God wants us to be different. And so he's written for us the scriptures to show us two things, to show us just how amazing Jesus really is, just what he accomplished on our behalf and how much that's worth, and also what he's made us to be now. That we're no longer helpless thralls of Satan, but we are servants and ambassadors of the Lord our God, filled with the Spirit of God. So when Satan comes, we do not face him alone, but we face him in the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the first verse, it says Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, specifically to be tempted by the devil. And he was in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. And he was hungry. One of my favorite understatements in Scripture. I can't go 40 hours without getting hungry. I sometimes can't go 40 minutes without getting hungry. Jesus went 40 days and 40 nights. And the reason for that was to show us that when we are at our weakest, that's where Satan's going to come after us. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread." The first temptation is to get what you want. Now, I just wonder, is that really a bad thing? Is it a bad thing to want to get what you want? Is it a bad thing to work to get what you want? Well, I guess it depends on what you want. How do you know if what you want is healthy? How do you know if what you want is good? Because if we check our own thoughts, if we check our own attitudes, if we check our own feelings, well, then pretty much everything that we want is good because we have a long list of reasons to defend what we want. Now, I want you to check your memory. Ever wanted something that wasn't good for you? Ask a smoker that. Ask an alcoholic that. Ask a liar that. Ask a sinner. Ask yourself. Ever been anything that you wanted? You knew it wasn't right, but you wanted it anyway. Sin is like that. Remember in the Old Testament lesson? Satan came and said, "You know, this fruit, this is good stuff. You're going to be like God." And yeah, God says don't do it, but you know, what does he know? He just doesn't want you to be like him. He doesn't want you to be as happy as you could be. You got to go for it. You got to go for what you want. Otherwise, you're never going to achieve your potential. And you remember how the Old Testament lesson read? When the woman saw that it was good for food and to attain wisdom, she bought it and she failed. Then she handed some to her husband and he failed. There's a reason that we can see that so clearly. There's a reason that we understand how that works and how that feels. It's because we've been there. We can always justify getting what we want. But Jesus says there is a different standard. Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God." The one thing that we need more than anything else is the word of our God. Now, there are other things that present themselves as more pressing. Whenever I do my budget, it seems like money's a little more pressing. When it reaches about 6:30 at night, it seems like sleep is a little more pressing. But remember when Mary and Martha visited Jesus? I mean, what would you do if you knew Jesus was coming to your house? Would you clean it? Would you make something special? Would you want your house to appear worthy for God himself to come. Would you worry about it? And when Jesus came, would you wait on him hand and foot? Would you make sure that everything that he could possibly want was available? Because it sounds like the right thing to do. Martha, would you get a little upset if your sister was sitting on the floor listening to stories while you're doing all the work? It doesn't always appear that the one thing we need beyond everything else is the word of the Lord our God. But there is nothing more important. Jesus said, the Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. There is nothing more important than the word of the Lord our God. It is not only our guide, although it is. It is not only the source of hope and wisdom, although it is. It's life. The word of our God is the only source of faith. It's the only source of life. And if we have a choice between bread and the word comes first. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus told us, don't worry. Don't worry about the stuff everyone worries about. Don't worry about food and clothes. Don't worry about shelter. Don't worry about all those things. Seek first. Remember how that goes? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will be given to you as well. Where else are you going to hear that? You're not going to hear it at work. You're not going to hear it in your own thoughts. Unless your thoughts are echoing the word of the Lord your God. Well, then, the devil, now you notice the name has changed. The first one, the tempter, the one who offers things. Now it's the devil, the adversary. You're not going to play? Let's see how you do. So the devil took him into the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple. And he said to him, if you're the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written. You want to play Bible games? I'll play Bible games. It is written. He will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Is that what the Bible says? Close. He missed something pretty important. But how would you know? How would you know, is this really what the Bible says? I have a list of a dozen sayings attributed to Scripture. I want you to count how many of these are what the Bible says. God helps those who help themselves. Cleanliness is next to godliness. Hate the sin, love the sinner. Money is the root of all evil. This too shall pass. If you work hard enough, you'll be successful. Just follow your heart and believe, and you can do anything. God will not give you more than you can handle. God just wants you to be happy. To thine own self be true. God works in mysterious ways. You just have to ask Jesus into your heart. Of those 12, how many are in Scripture? And maybe Before you answer that, how would you know? Would you know because somebody told you? Would you know because you've seen pastors' quizzes before and you know what the answer probably is? Or would you know because you are a disciple of Christ, a student of Scripture, that you live and breathe the Word of God, you commit it to memory, it is your life? You know how many are in Scripture? Two? One? Zero? Zero. None of them are in Scripture. Some are Shakespeare. Some are philosophers. One of them's Oprah. The ones that seem like they should be in there, God will not give you more than you can handle. God always gives us more than we can handle. He won't give us more than more. He won't allow us to be tempted beyond what we can bear. But we can't handle life without Him. And He's given us that. But He teaches us, don't try life without Him. The only way we can handle it is with Him. The devil's here. Can you handle him? Not by yourself. Another one that's close. Money is the root of all evil. Boy, you know, if that were true, we would not want money in church. I wouldn't want money in my house. I don't want the root of all evil in my house. The love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. There's plenty of evil that has nothing to do with money. And the love of money is a problem. It's a root of all kinds of evil. So He will command His angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Is that in there? Mostly. The way Scripture reads is He will command His angels concerning you to keep you in all your ways. Satan is tempting Jesus to do what he wants. Because God is going to take care of him anyway. Seek your own will. Do what you want. And watch God back you up. Now, which position would you rather have God in? You want him behind you watching, or you want him in front of you leading? I want him in front of me leading. I want to follow God. Not manipulate him. Submit to God, not test him. And so Jesus answers, again it is written, you shall not test the Lord your God. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their glory. And he said, I will give all these things to you if you will bow down and worship me. Tell you what, let's not do things the hard way. You got this sacrifice coming ahead of you? You don't have to. I can give you an easy way out. You came to save the world. Yes? I'll give it to you. No pain, no muss, no fuss. Bow down and worship. It's yours. What does the devil offer you? Does he offer you a little more money? All you have to do is change a few numbers on your tax return. All you have to do is be a little dishonest at work. Does he offer you an easy way out of trouble? All you have to do is lie a little. No one will know. I mean, what's the downside? You don't get hurt. They don't get hurt. No problem. Doesn't that sound good? I'll give it to you. All you have to do is bow down and worship me. It's the same temptation. I will make things easier for you if you just worship me. How many times have you fallen for that one? Then Jesus said to him, "Go away, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." I want you to memorize this one. Now, of course, that raises some questions. One, is he serious? I'm not in catechism anymore. Of course, if you are, you already are memorizing this one. But second, do I have to? What's going to happen if I don't? Well, can you answer that? What's going to happen if you don't memorize this? Well, you won't be as strong in Scripture as you could be. So do you have to? How strong in Scripture do you want to be? Memorize both parts of this. Worship the Lord your God. Do we do that? Or do we come to be entertained? Do we come to fulfill a responsibility? Do we come to see if I'm going to get something out of it? Or do we come to worship? Do we come to present our souls to the Lord our God and hear His word? To grow in our faith and receive the forgiveness of sins? Do we come to present our lives and thank the Lord our God that they are saved? To ask the Lord to work in us and through us so that we can serve Him? Think about that. Do we come to church to serve or to be served? It's not a very popular thing anymore to say church is where you go to serve. Because there's a growing trend to say, well, church is where I want to go and be served. I want the music to be good, I want the message to be good, and I don't want anyone to ask me to do anything. If I do something, I want it to be voluntary. I want it to be because I feel like it. I want to get what I want. And I want to do what I want. Oh, wait, those are the first two temptations. Are they not? Serve Him only. Now, consider the gifts that God has given to you. Are you using them to serve Him? Consider the wisdom and the power in His Word. Are you dedicating a significant part of your day to grow in it? Or do you kind of want other people to do that for you? If there are things in the ministry that need to be done, do you look to see who else can do it? Or do you ask, Lord, how can I serve? What part do you have for me to play? How can I glorify you? How can we together do your work, extend your kingdom, and save souls? How can we get this word out there? How can we get this word in there? Because there is so much that's trying to distract us. So much that wants to leech our time and our energy and our attention, promising to give us what we want. So that we can do what we want. And life will be easier And that's all three of those temptations. What does the Bible say? What is written? That needs to be our expertise. So we memorize, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. It's a really good start. And then find out, pray to the Lord your God, study Scripture. How can I serve him today? Not because somehow if I don't serve him enough that I'll be rejected, but because Jesus came and did everything for me. What a shame it would be to waste that. How opposed to our faith it would be to ignore that. How sinful it would be to pursue our own agenda when God wants us to celebrate his and to share his and to define ourselves by the crucifixion and resurrection of our Savior, who won where we lose, who gives life where we earn death, who provides meaning in an empty and listless world. His word is life, and that life is eternal in our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. And the peace of God that transcends all understanding will keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.